turn with me to Romans chapter 11. I'm not going to stay in Romans chapter 11, but it's my key verse here. Romans chapter 11, verse 29. As you're turning, I'd like to pray again. Father, what an awesome word, Lord, that you've going to give us today, Lord, because your word does not return void. It accomplished what it set out to do. Lord, there's people here going to say, man, you're reading my mail today because this is what I needed to hear. And so, Lord God, give us ears to hear, a mind to comprehend, and a heart that will receive your grafted word that will change us, Lord God, into the people you want us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Romans chapter 11, verse 29. For the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. My message today is God's calling on our life. You know, that word irrevocable, I had to look that up to tell you the truth. Again, it means you cannot revoke. You cannot revoke it. And revoke really means to annul. So you cannot annul the calling on your life. The devil can't annul the calling on your life. Once God gives it, he doesn't take it back.
Amen.
Again, God doesn't give something that he takes back. I want to tell you a story again. We're going to probably get into the Moses story, but I want to tell you a little bit of story. I don't really talk too much about myself, and you guys know that. But as a teenager, when I got saved in high school, I was a junior in high school at Vancouver High. And I was involved in, I was a good athlete, but I was also involved in drugs. And, you know, it was on a Sunday night that, that me and my brother was doing some, I think it was called monkey tranquilizers, you know, and it made you really goofy and made you laugh and stuff like that. And so we did these things, and after we went to go see a movie, my brother John and I went over to his girlfriend's house, and there were some people in the dining room, and they were talking about Jesus, and I'm like, oh, where did you bring me to? I thought we was going to come here and meet girls and stuff like that, and lo and behold, they're having some kind of Sunday night prayer meeting in this house. And this one lady, her name was Sister Ann, she came up, and she started talking to me about Jesus, and it was amazing. All of a sudden, I wasn't high anymore. I was really sober. And the things she started to say to me really started cutting deep to my heart. And I started to get a little scared because I'm thinking, you know, she's trying to tell me something I never really heard about. I had 8 years of Catholic grade school. And, you know about Christmas. You know about Easter. You know about religion and stuff like that. But you never heard things about how God wanted to have a personal relationship. And so all of a sudden, you know, she says, basically, would you like to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And I said, yes, I would. I'm thinking, what do I got to lose? If it doesn't work, I'll just go back and get high again, you know? So I received Christ. And it was a dramatic change. I mean, literally, my body trembled. It shook. We were driving home, and my brother's, I think it was a 68 or 68 Camaro. Boy, if he still had that, it'd be worth some money. But we're driving home, and we were just saying, this is the greatest high we've ever been on. And with me, God did really do a change in my life. I took the drugs that I had, and I dug a hole in Meredith. Sadly to say, my brother John, he thought he could, like, have the best of both worlds, but as you know, you cannot. You cannot serve two masters. Well, God gave me a zeal for him. It wasn't a zeal that I had, but God gave me a zeal. There was a brother named Aaron Delf who prophesied over me. He prayed. I was in the Pentecostal movement, and I believe when people prayed that God's word came alive. And he prophesied over me, and he said, Brother George, that God's called you to be an evangelist and stuff like that. And you know, I always loved sharing the Lord Jesus. Even at school, I remember preaching in the hallways. Years later, we'd be told that a guy I'd run into, he says, you know, there wasn't a day that had gone by that I didn't remember how you preached in the hallway. I never knew that because, you know, you preach and no one really responds like you'd like to. But here you hear 20 years later that people says the things that you preach. So, you know, as a young Christian and hearing these words of being an evangelist, I had these high expectations. I finally got out of high school and stuff like that, and I'm thinking, you know, I preach Jesus on the streets. We'd go downtown witnessing. We'd go outside the Agora. I don't know if you guys remember the Agora on Burning Door. It was a nightclub. They played rock and roll, and we'd be out standing outside sharing Jesus. We'd go to the concerts at the sports arena. We'd be sharing Jesus, and it was amazing how God really used us and led a lot of people to the Lord. Well, opportunity finally knocked, and there was a church that was looking for a youth pastor, so I applied for it. And when I didn't get that job as youth pastor, I was crushed because I felt like, you know, the kids loved me. I knew how to communicate to them. And I got somewhat, I have to say, discouraged a little bit. And next thing I know, I wasn't attending church like I used to. And you don't just backslide all of a sudden. You don't one day wake up and say, I'm going to backslide, okay? But I gradually, you know, drifted away from the faith of the church and stuff like that. And it really was devastating because 12 years later, you know, I'm still like, you know, trying to find my way as a Christian and in and up, you know, out of church and not being stable, trying to make deals with God and always falling back into sin. It was like some people, like today, when I tell this story, they can, you know, they can identify with it because they feel like every time they give their life to Jesus, all hell breaks loose. And that's what it was for 12 years. Every time I would try to get on track with the Lord, it seemed like the devil would come against me. And the next thing, I found myself back into the same sin again. But finally, 12 years after I had turned my back on the Lord, something awesome happened. In 1993, I went to a church, and a minister says, if there's anybody want healing in their body, and I'm thinking, here, I play a lot of sports, and I have like a hip pointer. I say, I'm going to go up there and see if this stuff is for real, you know? So I went up there, and the man laid hands on me. Next thing I know, I'm bawling like a baby. I'm crying almost uncontrollably. The Lord didn't heal me necessarily physically, but he healed me spiritually. And it was from that day forward, since 1993, I haven't turned back. And that's what I'm saying. God's gifts are irrevocable. Once he's called you, even though you might be like Moses, 40 years later, you're on the backside of the desert, his calling is still there. So maybe someone here today, you could think, well, you know, God called me one time, but I sort of messed that up. No, his calling is still there for you. And we're going to look at scriptures today and show you that. Let's turn to Exodus chapter 4, verse 10. Thank God his calling is irrevocable. Amen?
Amen.
Because if it wasn't, I wouldn't be here right now. I'd still be in this wicked turnstile. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 10, it says, then Moses said to the Lord, please, Lord, I have never been eloquent. You can identify with that. Neither recently, nor in time past, nor since you have spoken to your servant, for I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. Now, when I first read this, it was like, you know, we always make fun. Well, you know, Moses had a stuttering problem. He had issues, you know, with trying to communicate and stuff like that. But I think it's more than that. I think Moses is saying, you know what? Lord, 40 years ago you called me, and I thought you called me to deliver your people, and I wasn't able to do it. Matter of fact, I made a mess of it. And I tried to hide that Egyptian in the sand, and even my own people turned against me, saying, who made you judge? Who made you a prince? So I think what we're seeing here is more than him not just being able to communicate, but him to be in a place where God can use him. God can use him. He's come to the place where he realized it's not all that education that he had back in Egypt. It's not all that military experience that he had back when he defeated the Ethiopians. It was when he came to the place to end of himself where he didn't even feel like he could even communicate to people. See, that's a good place to be. years later, after he had tried to deliver his people in his strength. Now it's humble and broken. And maybe feels like I'm not the right person for the job. Because I tried this before, and that's maybe some of us here today. You feel like, well, I would really like to get involved in ministry, but I'm scared of failure. And you know what? It ain't about you anyways. If you can just let go and let God, you don't have to worry about failures. Because God, he's the one who's going to do it. And he never fails. You know, in the book of Acts, it tells a really good story of Moses and his life. Let's go to Acts chapter 7. Tell them I'm busy, okay? All right, Acts chapter 7, verse 22. Amen? Acts chapter 7, verse 22. Moses was educated in all the learning of the Egyptians. And he was a man of power in words and deeds. So this is a little bit more than what we read in Exodus, isn't it? This was a man who, again, he had a great education. He was a mighty military leader. But when he was approaching the age of 40, it entered his mind to visit his brethren, the sons of Israel. So you see that this is talking about him before God had this encounter with him. So we see here that he went to go visit his brethren, the sons of Israel, verse 24. And when he saw one of them being treated unjustly, he defended him. And he took vengeance for the oppressed by striking down the Egyptian. Apparently, this Egyptian probably was a taskmaster and he was oppressing the people. Remember how bad the children of God had it back then. They were mistreated. They were to try to make bricks that even they didn't have the material to make it with. And so Moses sees this Egyptian oppressing his brother. So he's going to feel like, I'm going to be the deliverer here. And he supposed that his brethren understood that God was granting them deliverance through him. But they did not understand. See, God did call Moses. But when Moses was trying to deliver the people, it said that he basically did it in his own strength. He really didn't seek God when he seen the oppression of the people and God, how I should do it. Again, Moses believed in his early days God called him to be the deliverer of his people. He thought through his knowledge and his military strength, he was able to do this job. But things went wrong. And when things went wrong, he went running for his life. And like us, sometimes when things don't go right, like me, when I applied for that job and didn't get it, you know what? I got an attitude and I ran. And it's like with us, sometimes we expect God to do certain things our way. But see, and I'll say this and I'll say it again. Prayer is when we line up with God's will, not trying to get God to understand and do our will, but when we line up with God's will.
Amen.
In verse 26, it says, on the following day, he appeared to them as they were fighting together, and he tried to reconcile them in peace. He's not only trying to be a deliverer, he's trying to what? Be a peacemaker. Saying, men, you are brethren. Why do you injure one another? But the one who was injuring his neighbor pushed him away, saying, who made you ruler and judge over us? And you do not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you? At this remark, Moses fled, and he became an alien in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. Wow. You know, one day he feels like he did accomplish something. He delivered the oppression that this Egyptian was putting on his brother. He probably was feeling good about himself. Sometimes when we do something, we accomplish something, even in our own strength, we feel good about ourselves. But then we realize that there's no fruit there behind it because, you know, the fruits of the flesh are really no good. But was the deliverer. Now he's running for his life, and now he needs to be delivered. I'm sure Moses questioned the calling of God on his life for the next 40 years. For the next 40 years, he was probably thinking, you know, I think God called me to the point where maybe he didn't even believe, maybe he misunderstood God's calling, and maybe now he's starting to believe. And the devil will put these thoughts in our heads. Well, God really didn't call you anyway, so what are you worried about? From a place where we know that God's calling is on our lives to a place, well, maybe God really didn't call me after all. No, he's called you. And his calling is irrevocable. That means it's forever. This is an awesome story here that we see. In verse 30, it says, after 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning thorn bush. When Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight. And as he approached to look more closely, there came the voice of the Lord. So it was the voice of the Lord. It was the Lord in that fiery bush here we see. Could this be the voice of Jesus? Calling out to Moses. After 40 years of silence, he hears the voice of the Lord again. Wow, that's a long time. But see, God lives outside of eternity. Time is nothing to him. What is a day? Like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years as is a day. Keep your hand here, but let's go to John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 56. Actually, I'd like the account that Stephen has given. Stephen has given the religious leaders a history story in Exodus chapter 7. And they don't really care for his story. Because you know what they do? They pick up stones to kill him. In John chapter 8, verse 56, it says, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. And he saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you are not yet 50 years old. Have you seen Abraham? Now these are the religious people, the Jews, who are trying to always put Jesus on the spot. And yet, here Jesus says in verse 58, Jesus said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. Jesus is the great I am. Now what does Moses say to God? What does he say to Jesus? Because I said this was Jesus probably in that burning bush. It was his voice. Jesus says, tell them that I am is the great. He is the great I am, Jesus is. So it was Jesus speaking in that burning bush. He is the great I am. Let's go back to Acts chapter 7. Verse 32, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And Moses shook with fear and would not venture to look. The presence of the Lord, wow, was so great, a holy fear overcame him that he shook. I mean, the presence of God, you know, sometimes we sometimes think, oh man, I would just love the presence of God. I tell you, if the presence of God came in the power, we'd be all on our floors kissing this carpet, okay? Because his glory is so great. As John the Apostle in Revelations, he says, I felt like a man that was dead. I was like a dead man in his presence. So we see here in the presence of the Lord, Moses is shaking with a holy fear that overtook him. God needs to do a shaking over his people. I wish God would just shake us up to the place where, you know, that we would have such a holy fear for him. That we would just come to church flippantly. But that we would come because he's a holy God. And we need to be holy. Because without holiness, no man can see him. But we don't need to fear man. What man can do, Jesus says, don't fear man, for need a holy fear of God. We can't. I was listening to Adrian Rogers today, and he was talking about, you know, the reverence and the holiness, and how sometimes people, even who go to church, they might be living in sin. And they come to church and think it's all right because God didn't judge them right away over their sins. And they continue to live this lifestyle. But because judgment delayed isn't judgment stayed. Because judgment will come if we're not living a righteous and holy life that we only can live through Him anyways. In Acts chapter 7, verse 35, it says, "This Moses, whom they disowned, saying, 'Who made you a ruler and judge,' is the one whom God sent to be both a ruler and a deliverer with the help of an angel who appeared to him in the thorn bush." Remember, the word angel means messenger. When it says angel of the Lord, that's speaking of Jesus Christ. He is the messenger of Jehovah. So he's not an angel like Michael or anything, because they've been created. But he is the one who created them. And that's where some cults get mixed up, because they look at Jesus, oh yeah, but he isn't Michael the archangel, he isn't Gabriel, no, he is the messenger. Remember, angel means messenger. He is the one that brings the message even here to Moses. Again, God sent him to be the deliverer with the help of the angel of the Lord. This is Jesus. Again, angel means messenger. Verse 36. "This man led them out, performing wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, in the Red Sea, in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the sons of Israel, 'God will raise up a prophet like me from your brethren.'" Who is that speaking about? Jesus. Jesus would be raised up, because he is called the Son of David in his human form, but he's also the Son of God in his spirit form. He is a prophet, priest, and king. He fills all the titles. And Moses is prophesying that God is going to raise up the deliverer. Now, Moses was a deliverer only through the help of God. But now Jesus is the deliverer. Again, it's important that you know that. There will always be those unwilling to be obedient to the call of God. But we will always, again, want to be the ones who go back to Egypt, who go back to the world, to try to save those who are in bondage. Because Moses wasn't in bondage anymore, being in the wilderness. I mean, he had taken on a wife, he had children, he had flocks, he wasn't a slave anymore. But he knew his people were still a slave back in Egypt. It's like us, when God brings us out of darkness into his marvelous light, it's that we might declare or proclaim his glory. We shouldn't just be sitting on our blessed assurance, but we should be wanting to go back to Egypt, go back to the world, and pull those who are in bondage out of bondage. Amen. That they might be free. Because he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen. So we see that. God's gift, his calling is irrevocable. But we have a free will to choose. You have a free will to say, "Lord, I know you've called me, but you know what? I choose not to." You can do that. God's given you a free will. It'd be a sad thing. You'd be the most miserable of people.
What if you can't pull them out, Pastor George?
Well, all our job is, as I said earlier today, is that we speak the word in love. You know, the Bible says speak the truth in love. We're to present the gospel to them, and we just hope that God draws them. It's only our job as the sow the seeds. It's God as the one who's going to save. Amen. So we see here that God's gift is irrevocable. His calling on our life, man, doesn't change. Hopefully, like Moses, we have the opportunity to choose to walk in God's calling. churches, everybody's just concerned about their own blessed assurance instead of the lost. You know, I think one of the best things God ever did for me, that after I came back in 93, that he opened up the door to minister in prisons. And for over 20 years now, I've ministered in prisons. And I think that was one of the best things. Because of that, I knew that I couldn't preach the gospel if I wasn't living the gospel. I don't know, there's preachers out there who can do it, but I'm not one of them, okay? Because, I mean, I can't even be in an argument with my wife and try to go preach somewhere. I always have to kiss and make up, you know, before I go preach. Because the Word of God teaches that if you're not even right with your wife, that your prayers will even be hindered.
Amen.
And I don't want my prayers or my preaching to be hindered because of some stubbornness or because of some sin that I have towards my wife. So it's important that if we are to do God's calling, that we have to understand that there are guidelines. And yes, the Bible tells us in the book of James that a teacher has a greater responsibility and accountability. And that's what was so good for me, is that when I got into the prison ministry, I had to be accountable not only to God, but to my leaders and to the people I was preaching to. And that's a good thing. But the old famous Cheech and Chong says responsibility is a heavy responsibility. You know what I'm saying? So some people don't want responsibility. You think it's easy to take on all the responsibilities and have to deal with a lot of people a lot of times? It's not an easy responsibility, but it's a great calling. It's so rewarding. And some people don't want the responsibilities, but they don't realize how much they're missing out on. Because when I see a soul get saved, it's the greatest thing. When I see a young man we've mentored for years grow up to be a godly young man, that you can't, you know, money can't buy that. When I see people on the streets run and say, "Hey brother, I was the guy in prison," he says, "Now I'm going to church." You know, but money can't replace what God has done through the preaching of his word. And you know what? This is just the earthly things. The Bible says that, you know, great are our rewards in heaven. You know? But I know when I get to crowns, that it ain't going to be for my glory. I want to cast them down at Jesus' feet. Because really, I've been in bondage for 12 years. I didn't ever know if I'd ever come back to church. But God knew, because I just read this the other day. He knows the beginning from the end from the beginning.
Amen.
And he knows that his gift was irrevocable, that he would get me to a place where I really had no choice, you know. It's like he chooses you, and it's like it becomes, it's like Paul says, it's no longer I who lives, but it's Christ who lives in me. And now I don't belong to myself. Honestly say, I belong to Christ, and I want to please Christ. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 11, so you young people who struggle at times, you know, in your faith, don't give up. Exodus chapter 4, verse 11, and the Lord said to him, "Who has made man's mouth, or who makes him mute or deaf, or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord?" Verse 12. "Now then go." That's a command right there. He commands them, "Then go. And I, even I, will be with your mouth and teach you what you are to say." So he's giving them a command. "Now you go, and I will teach you, and I'll even put the words in your mouth." Wow. All we have to do is be willing for God to use us, and he does all the rest. What else could you ask for? All we have to do is be a willing vessel that he can use. And that's what he's looking for. He's not looking for abilities. You don't have to be some great singer. You don't have to be some great theologian. All you have to, it ain't about abilities, it's about availability. Again, it's God's gift in you, the Holy Spirit. He will speak through us to is speaking to some of you today, because I know sometimes we get discouraged and felt like we're failures and feel like, man, God called me, but I messed up and I don't think I can do what God's calling. No, that's a lie from the pit of hell. Because I fell about as much as you could fall. I fell into all kinds of depravity. Matthew chapter 10, verse 16. Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So, you know what? It is going to be dangerous out there, right?
Yeah.
But be shrewd as serpents and heart and innocent as doves. But beware of men, for they will hand you over to the courts and scourge you in their synagogues. That means, basically, they're going to like not even want you in your church, their churches. And you will even be brought before governors and kings for my sake as a testimony to them and to the Gentiles. And when they hand you over, do not worry about how or what you are to say, for it will be given to you in the hour what you are to say. So you don't even have to worry about, I'm not a good member, I can't remember scriptures that much, I'm not really that good of a speaker. You know what? You don't even have to worry about that. God's going to give you something to say to them.
Amen.
And it's going to be greater than you could ever imagine.
Amen.
Verse 20. For it is not you who speaks. There you go. It ain't you who speaks. But it is the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you.
Amen.
It's the Lord. It's the Lord who's going to speak through you. All he's looking for is a yielding vessel. You can have a third grade education and God can use you to speak to people, professors in college, and they won't even be able to fight against you. Remember what it says in Acts chapter 4. It says they were unlearned and uneducated. If you look up that root word, it means ignoramus. They were ignorant. But it says they had been with Jesus. And when you're with Jesus, man, he takes you and he can speak through you to do what he wants you to do. It is not you, but the Holy Spirit, what you are going to do with God's calling on you. It's God's calling on you. And he's calling you today. I don't know about you, but I have great expectations for this church. And you know what? My expectations probably are minute to God's expectations.
Amen.
Minute. Because his word says he does exceedingly, abundantly, above. That means, like, more than you could ever imagine. Now, when we prayed for Bobby Monday night, and we prayed that God would heal him, now, didn't we really think that he'd go to the hospital and the doctors would say, hey, you have no blockage. You don't need them stents put in your heart. See, God did exceedingly, abundantly, above what we could ever ask or think. Now, we could say, oh, yeah, we knew Bobby was going to go to Finley and the doctor was going to say, hey, you can go back home. You don't need this operation. No, we might imagine it. It might have crossed our minds. But see, that's God.
Amen.
We have a picture of what God could do in this area. I'm telling you what, if God would reveal to his plan, it would blow our minds. What did he tell the prophet? He says, even if I told you, you wouldn't believe it, you know?
Right.
And it's like, even if God told us what he wants to do, it would be so awesome.
We wouldn't imagine what he could do.
Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, but entered in the mind of man what God wants to do and what God has prepared for those who love him.
Amen.
Now, if you feel like that God's called you, and you feel like you screwed up a little bit, and you feel like, well, man, God took his calling off me because I messed up. Maybe because you went through a marriage and it failed. No, none of them things matter. Because gift and this calling is irrevocable. That means if he's called you, this calling is still on your life.
It's yours for life.
So we're going to open these altars again. And we're going to ask you that if you feel like you need a touch from God, and you need to come to these altars and say, Lord, I know you've called me. I know I've messed up. Just like Moses waited 40 years. I know there's nobody in here that's waited 40 years.